I think we need to go backwards in order to think about what's happened over the past 30 or 40 years in terms of the higher education scene globally. So we go back to that historical context, the formation of, shall we say, a type of social contract between the state and the university. That very much happened at the beginning of the 19th century in Germany and in a few other countries, and was exported to the United States as well. I would argue that that contract was based on three different areas within the university. The first is between the issue of the curriculum, who has control of what goes on in the classroom. Secondly, in terms of research, who has the decision-making power in terms of what gets researched and what an academic can say. And I would argue that that's very much based on the Kantian notion of public reason. And the third area that we might want to think about is the relationship between the institution and the state. So who controls the university? Who has the power to make decisions? Is it the state or the institution? Now, different countries in Europe made different decisions about that. The US very much follows, I would say, the German model, which is that the academic has ultimate academic freedom in terms of what they write and what they say, what they research. They have control in the classroom and over the curriculum. And the institution has a kind of a sort of a strange relationship with the state. It's not very formalized, but it's kind of like, well, if you don't bother us, we won't bother you. But at the same time, the state will give money to state institutions in order to function. So the notion behind this kind of rapprochement between the academic sector and the state is that the university and higher education itself is a public good and a social good, and that the university will support certain things that the state is interested in. So, for instance, nation building, the idea of who we are and what we are. Also in terms of, shall we say, social justice issues, that, you know, somebody can live the American dream, they can go to university, they can get a degree, and there will be a redistribution of wealth and maybe a change in their class status, et cetera, et cetera. So the university was accepted as a public good and as a social good, and as long as they do their work, we kind of leave them alone to do it, you know, and we have this rapprochement. So that was the kind of the historical background. However, in the 1970s and 80s, we have a change in a lot of that thinking connected with the notion of an information society, or as we call it today, the knowledge economy. So the knowledge economy posits that we're kind of in a post-industrial scenario right now, and that what we'll be looking to in terms of the future, that our economy will not be based on manufacturing, because that's all gone to China. Instead, it'll be based on the production, the promulgation, and the sorting of knowledge. Now, if you think of our economy being based in that situation, then our needs moving forward as an economy are not people who know how to work in factories. They're people who know how to use computers. They're people who know how to be innovative in terms of the production of knowledge, etc. So an economy that is growing and developing is an economy that has got people there who can do those types of, who can fulfill those types of functionalities. Now, this means that we need a highly educated workforce, which is predominantly white collar rather than blue collar. So the kind of the theory was, and still is, that we need to suddenly move a lot more people into higher education and get them through that in order for the economy to grow and develop. So we see in the 1980s, it started in America, but now it's spread globally, a significant increase in the number of students who go to university. So when I went to university, I'm sufficiently old to be from just before that time. And in my day in the UK, say maybe 10 to 15% of students went to university. Now it's something like 45%. So you can see it's been a radical change. And if you look today in the US, you will notice that the expectation is that in order to succeed, you have to go to college, right? I mean, that's the rhetoric we all grow up in. So there's been a really huge change, and that's had a significant impact on the sector, based on this idea of the knowledge economy. However, if we dissect this knowledge economy a little bit, and we can go into ramifications for this for higher education later, but let's just go back to that knowledge economy idea, because this is where the neoliberalism comes in. Because essentially, the knowledge economy and the basis of higher education development on the notion of the knowledge economy is where neoliberalism has come into higher education. The knowledge economy idea is, first of all, based on the idea that higher education is not about a social good or just a broad public good, i.e. it's just a good thing to have a university. It's now saying that university is an economic good, right? And that secondly, that we should be pursuing economic good above everything else. If we go back to the idea of a knowledge economy, it is promulgated on the idea that economic growth is a good per se, right? We have to keep growing, yeah? Whereas in fact, there is no rationale behind that. That growth in itself, economic growth in itself, is a desirable thing, right? So if we look, for instance, at the role of higher education in international organizations or in federal policy making or in state strategies, everything is connected to the effect that universities can have on economic growth, with economic growth as the end goal, the desideratum of any state strategic planning. Not, shall we say, that everybody is in better houses, or that everybody can move more fluidly between classes, or that there's more social justice, or that we're dealing with climate change. Everything has been realigned to the economy. So we can't any longer think about stuff like social justice without thinking about economic growth. Whereas, say, 40, 50 years ago, that was not axiomatic. That connection was not clear. So this means that neoliberalism's impact has been very much through this knowledge economy rhetoric. And it has naturalized the idea of the economic good and economic growth as being something that we all should be seeking to achieve. We don't question it. And that's the function of what a good higher education system should be doing.
It's actually my second book, False Promises. I did it while I was a teacher in community college. And that was 4 days a week teaching in Staten Island, and 3 days a week, end to end of those days, except to eat dinner and lunch sometimes, writing and reading. And you know, and I did it for 2 or 3 years, and I actually produced a book. But how many times can you actually do that? You know, you have no other life, right? I mean, there's, you know. You want to go to a movie? I didn't go to a movie for two and a half years. That's really true. And that's increasingly what is going on. Meanwhile, 75% of teachers, many of whom have PhDs at the university level, are adjuncts, and they teach two courses or three courses a semester, make. And maximum $4,000, $5,000 a course, often less. So figure you're making $30,000 a year, and then you work on summers, so you may make another $10,000. You're making $40,000. You know, it's like a postdoc, but it's an adjunct life, and people are now making their careers as adjuncts. The purpose for which you actually went to school to start with, especially if you're a dedicated person in your field, is subverted by the nature of the job. Now, that's neoliberalism, by the way. That's what it is. It's the transformation of the labor market into a contingent labor market.
I was pretty shocked to learn that about 30 years ago, investing practices changed dramatically. And this was largely due to the chief investment officer, David Swensen, at Yale University, who was experimenting with new ways for universities to invest their money and make larger returns. A lot of what he focused on was moving more money into riskier ventures, private equity, hedge funds, venture capital, and out of some of the more secure asset classes like bonds and stocks. And what this led to in the short term was massive windfall profits. There were very few people at the time approaching investing with this strategy, and being first to the game, they made a lot of money. However, like most good ideas, or seemingly good ideas, people started picking up on what they were doing, and pretty soon the endowment model of investing became the standard practice for colleges and universities across the country, and even pension funds. And what this meant was that more and more money was being funneled into businesses that were less and less accountable to the public and less regulated. And in 2008, we saw really the fruit of these practices come to bear in the economic crisis of 2008. During a 2-year period, Harvard University, for example, lost 29.5% of its endowment. It went from being a $37 billion endowment to a $26 billion one. And simultaneously, you had many smaller institutions losing 20, 30, 40% of their endowments, which are meant to be savings, nest eggs for the universities for future generations. And, you know, with $26 billion, you can rebuild, you can start again, you can be resilient. However, at many of these smaller schools with much smaller savings, this was a really dire situation. And what a lot of these schools ended up doing was pushing the loss back onto the people that most needed the support. So they raised tuition massively over a short period of time. They cut programs that were deemed non-essential to the university functions. They made it almost impossible for new professors to achieve tenure, and they started hiring fleets of adjunct faculty to work for very minuscule pay and very few benefits. And there were cuts to unions and some of the other worker benefits for folks providing essential services on campus. And what we saw with this as well was that during this entire period of restructuring of endowments, new positions had opened up in the administrations of these universities. There were chief financial officers that were coming on board for the first time. There were chief investment officers and entire investment departments being created, where the employees were compensated and really rewarded for achieving higher and higher endowment returns. And it was with little oversight as to how they were making those returns, how they were generating them. And so what we saw, and really the space that we're in today, is we still have many of these overpaid administrative positions, while teachers and faculty members are being left with kind of the scraps.
All right. So I'm going to talk now a little bit about the impact of this change from higher education as a public or as a social good to an economic good. And I'm going to start off by talking a little bit about the impact that the enormous growth in the student population in America and worldwide has had on these different relationships between the state and the university, and how in particular it's formed new modes of power, particularly the power relationship between the state and the institution. So if we go back to my kind of historic three of the curriculum and what happens in the classroom and the state, we can say that that's pretty much still intact. The second area, which is the relationship between the institution and the state, has definitely changed, because whilst there has been enormous pressure to take on more and more students, the funding from the state has not necessarily gone up in companion with the increase of students, and therefore the institution is being pushed to find funding in other ways. So the new version of state control there is not direct. They haven't broken that social contract, so to speak, but it's now an indirect form of control. So we can say that they have broken it, in fact, even though it's not so visible. And then the third area is academic freedom. And I would argue that that also has been broken, because the institution is being pushed to find new financing options. It has had to intervene in what an academic might say or research or publish. And I would argue that essentially that notion of public reason has now been privatized. So let's go back to that notion of indirect state control. So if I, as the state, now say to you as a university, I'm not going to give you so much money this year. So then the university says, either we have to cut back or we have to expand. So the state has a policy, and this happens in England, it's happened in France, it's happened all over the world. So the state almost deliberately withholds funds in order to push an institution that may not wish to expand further, to take in more students, and therefore increase the number of students as a percentage-wise of the population entering that so-called knowledge economy. So there has been, two forces from the state. The first one is that let's not give them as much money and then they'll have to expand, but also we can't possibly afford to put that money that we would need to put into the institution for it to be fully funded still by the state, or partially funded by the state, to achieve the increase that we would want. So there are two pushes from that point of view. But it's being used very deliberately as a tool by the state. So then what does the institution do? First of all, they increase the number of students. If they're a really prestigious institution, they're able to say, well, hey, we've got tons of money coming in from other places. Let's go to the third world and buy up all their farmland. That's a slight dig at Harvard and various other places. But we can build up our endowment from that perspective, or rely on our endowment. But many institutions, like the one we're sitting in at Kane University, isn't in the position of having this big endowment, and therefore really has to increase and, shall we say, marketize its approach. So the first way is through the increase in number of students. The second thing that they need to do is to follow a couple of models that are out there, one of which that became very famous in the 1990s is the entrepreneurial university model. The entrepreneurial university says that a university needs to get out there and make money in different ways and utilize its resources to make money in order to then protect core areas such as, say, its philosophy program or its political science program that can't necessarily go out and make tons of money, because they don't tend to give philosophers lots of money for what they do. So that was the idea. And in order to do that, universities had to kind of reorganize themselves and professionalize some of their core divisions so that they could make themselves ready to get in that type of money. So we saw also a change in the organization of managements and divisions. So the movement then was away from universities being run by academics, because let's face it, most academics aren't brilliant at doing small business incubators, or they don't tend to organize conferences and events or find ways to use the dormitory during the lag time in the summer, all of those things. And so increasingly, universities started to hire people who really were professionals in that area. They also had to hire people who were professionals in media and PR, because you have to get out there and you have to be bigger and brighter than the university down the street to bring in those students. So we're all competing for the same market. So as a consequence, we saw the senior management teams of universities gradually, the academic side would get squeezed further and further to the side, to the point where you now have often senior management teams where, you know, academic affairs can just be one or two people in the room, and everybody else is representing media and PR or enrollment management or conferences and events, etc., etc. This is a concept called new managerialism, which kind of went alongside that development of the entrepreneurial university. Secondly, the universities had to reorganize so that they had, shall we say, soft walls, so that research was organized towards interests from outside. So, for instance, you'd make a relationship with a pharmaceutical company. You would have the pharmaceutical company connected to your university, preferably maybe even using the same facilities. Research would go on in your labs. But then, of course, that means that the type of research that is going on in your institution is probably going to be whatever that pharmaceutical company wants. But the university and the pharmaceutical company partner together, make some money together, and in that way, the university is able to bring in some extra funding. So if you look, for instance, if you go to MIT today, you'll see that surrounding MIT are all these high-tech firms, because they're able to use the resources of MIT, they're able to use the graduates of MIT, the researchers of MIT, the library and facilities in order to further their own research agendas. So that kind of, as I said, that differentiation between public reason and private business and private business interests has disappeared, essentially. Now, we make all those changes in order to bring the money in, and as I said, to keep our philosophy program going. Unfortunately, the problem with the entrepreneurial university model is that many universities were not able and are still not able to make all their money in that way. And also, if, say, for instance, your STEM building makes a ton of money through biotech, when the president comes along and says, well, I want some of that money to fund philosophy, that's when it all kind of comes to a grinding halt. First of all, because the president very rarely will go to the biotech people and say, I want some of your money to fund philosophy, because they'll say, hang on a second, I can see that philosophy doesn't bring me in anything, and maybe not many students want to really study it because they see there aren't many jobs as a philosophy graduate, whereas I've got this great biotech thing going on here, so why don't we get rid of the philosophy department and just focus on biotech? And the biotech people say, hey, we're bringing in all this money. Why on earth would we give it to somebody else? So, and the people who are fundraising say, no, you don't want to invest in this. You want to invest in that. So that original conception of the entrepreneurial university was a nice theory, but it never played through because of the market forces that were occurring. Because we'd entered into the market, the university and the market were no longer separate. What this has led to is that many universities are now no longer, they're moving away from the comprehensive university model and are now moving into something which is really rather more of a professional school. Even today, if I want to have a new program in the state of New Jersey, one of the first things I have to answer is, what's the economic need? What are the job projections for this program? You know, will there be jobs for graduates from this specific field? Not, it's a good thing in and of itself to study this particular area, and it's up to the graduate to see what they want to do afterwards.
The federal government is planning on cutting $150 billion from federal financial aid, which will impact roughly 9 million students across the United States. So this is Pell Grants, this is the current loan system. What a lot of people don't see is the truly personal face of this. When $150 billion are cut from financial aid, that means millions of students across the country will wake up next semester wondering what happened to their financial aid. And they're not going to see it as this huge system bearing down upon them that has removed their financial aid and made their lives more unstable. They're going to see this as an individual failure, either on their parts or the parts of their families, at most on the part of the university or the college itself. So I recall myself losing my Pell Grants my last year in college and wondering what I did wrong in terms of filling out my financial aid forms, or maybe I'd used too much of my work study money the previous semester. When in reality, that was a bill that was passed by Congress that allowed or prevented people utilizing their Pell Grants for a certain length, thus forcing a lot of students who were in college to begin taking out loans, or many others consider dropping out towards the end of their academic career. It's something that is so across the board and intersects with every facet of university life, where students on an individual basis can't conceive of their lives outside of how their degrees must benefit them financially, or like how whatever activities, interactions that they have with other human beings must benefit them in the long term financially, where everyone is becoming their own like individual private corporation that they're trying to market and sell to each other. While you have this impending, like this big hammer of like financial aid cuts and divestment from public education, or like this like sword singing, swinging above everyone, and people are just like ignoring it because they're thinking that like one day I'll be king, like I could be Damocles one day, and not realizing that through collective action, they could get rid of that sword. They could get rid of all the pressures that are keeping all of them down. They don't have to think about like what their future job will be, or like how much money they need to make. They can think about their dreams and their aspirations, about their community, but we're not in a place where we can think about that.
I guess in thinking about the impact of neoliberalism on higher education and what can be done about it, the first thing that comes to mind is the particularly good position, relatively speaking, that Rutgers is in compared to other institutions because of the degree of unionization here. It allows for certain degree of fight back that much of higher education is simply in no position to mount. So, for example, at a place like this, where you've got 26,000 people who work at an institution where somewhere between 65 and 70,000 students attend school at the State University of New Jersey, 20,000 of us are unionized. And I'm the lead organizer of the faculty union, the Rutgers AAUP-AFT. It basically means that we have a means, the potential at least, there's no guarantees, of collaborating among faculty, staff, you know, all the people who really make Rutgers work. And that's precisely the kinds of things that we do to fight back, to push back. So, for example, you have the same people who own and run the Financial Times and the Economist, Pearson, are the folks who brought you all these miserable standardized tests throughout the education system in this country. Well, they're also the people who've tried to impose absolutely horrible online learning contracts on our faculty. Throughout the country, people have just simply had to suck it up and deal with it. Here, unionized faculty were positioned themselves and made the effort to wage a fight back against Pearson and managed to get the faculty to vote to boycott its lousy contracts that, you know, run roughshod over intellectual property rights, academic freedom, say nothing of the, you know, the huge financial take. We have been able to safeguard tenure and for at least a chunk of the faculty, but not enough. We are in a pitch battle right now to better the conditions and the pay for adjuncts, for part-time lecturers. And if you think about the impact of kind of adjunctification in higher ed. And by that I mean, it used to be when I was in college in the 1980s, that almost all of the faculty were either tenured or tenure track, which meant that they had the freedom to really explore controversial ideas, to dissent, and of course they had job security. Well, now it's completely flipped. Now closer to 20 to 25% of faculty at not just universities like Rutgers, but throughout the United States have any kind of job protection like tenure, and all the rest are insecure faculty. That is, they may work full-time and have contracts and some security, or they're part-time and have very, very few benefits and no security. But really, that's a very dangerous position for higher education to be. I mean, think about what that means for not just the people who do that work, but for the students, the millions of students in this country who are kept away from dissenting ideas, kept away from controversial concepts and experimentation and studies, precisely because there's no academic freedom for the people who are teaching without tenure. And so you think about it in terms of labor, but I also think we have to think about it in terms of intellectual pursuits and education and scholarship and all the things that are not being done right now, because there simply is no protection of academic freedom at this moment for all of those, you know, million plus faculty across the country who have no tenure and are not going to get it under the current setup. So we're a fighting organization. We're a union that is in the midst of some transformation, some reorganization, and getting really members deeply involved. And they know they have a stake in what's happening here at Rutgers, but are, for many of them, discovering the union for the first time as a means through which to challenge some of the worst aspects of neoliberalism. So, for example, being able to not only protect salaries and benefits, but actually push back around things like, you know, sort of corporate priorities of management at a place like this that has a bottomless pit of cash when it comes to athletics spending, which one can be, I'm pro sports personally, but I'm not pro gutting the academic mission of a university in order to pay for a football team. And that's what appears to be happening. And yet when it comes to things like the humanities and the arts and languages and things of that nature that really, you know, are about cultural development and about intellectual development that don't have an immediate remuneration, a dollar sign, those kinds of things go by the wayside or being slashed away at, while you have things like, you know, management salaries, for example, or, you know, things like athletic spending or a building boom around certain things that may not be needed, you know, is where the resources go. So unions have become absolutely crucial to press back against really these kind of misplaced corporate, almost Walmartized priorities that have encroached on higher education. I think another front of battle for us, even though it's a faculty union, we teach students and we ourselves are people are burdened by student debt. Student debt is huge for faculty. I mean, certainly faculty who are younger, who've gone through not just their bachelor's degree, master's, but a PhD, and many of the people have had not had full funding throughout their academic careers, and then enter into the professoriate already owing tens of thousands, and some, frankly, owing in excess of $100,000 in student debt. This is a huge battle for higher ed right now, and not just, again, for the students, but for the professors. One program that we are trying to take advantage of and publicize to our own faculty is that when you work in for a state, you can actually have part of your student debt actually waived by entering into a government program that, after 10 years of paying off your student debt at a sliding scale, will waive the rest of it. It's one of these hidden programs that most people don't even know anything about, and it actually takes unions to even introduce this reality into the lives of our own members. We have a lot of fights that are ahead of us, big, big challenges that aren't just financial. It's really about the soul of higher education that's being fought over right now. And I think that some of the ideological project of neoliberalism, which isn't just about privatizing everything, it isn't just about monetizing everything, though it is about all of those things. Part of it is really about, it seems to me, like almost gutting the capacity of people to dream. And so I think the targeting of the humanities, of literature, of fine arts, of all the kinds of disciplines that aren't easily monetized, but also are about getting people to learn how to think analytically and even dream about the world being different from what it currently is, are under the knife right now as a result of neoliberal cutbacks, because those things are in a sense dangerous to a society that aims to just sort of, you know, bring everything down to the profit motive. Because if you can conceive of a world different from the one we currently live in, then you can potentially organize to get there. And that's a dangerous prospect for a system that is trying to narrow the vision and lower the expectations and stamp out not just our capacity to challenge corporate priorities, but to even dream of a world different from the one we currently live in.
Unfortunately, the rhetoric around the knowledge economy and the turn from the university as a social good to an economic good has become so pandemic that it's extremely difficult to see a way forward, because it's become, shall we say, naturalized into our conversation. So it's obvious to everybody that economic growth is a good thing. It's obvious to everybody that going to college will help you economically, and that's the main reason to do it. It's obvious that a university should be oriented towards economic growth. So things that weren't obvious 30 or 40 years ago are now completely obvious. And it's very hard to kind of see a way forward from those set of axioms, shall we say. But obviously things have changed, and therefore they can change again. So how might that happen? Well, there's two kind of interesting glimmers, I would say. First of all, this notion of the economic good has been very much embraced by the international organizations, by the World Bank, by the UN, by OSCE. So it's in all the benchmarks, all the millennial goals, et cetera, et cetera. Anything to do with higher education is now pegged this way internationally. And so everybody is following that same rhetoric. And it has very much since the Second World War been a world that has seen itself in terms of these kind of like the building of super blocks, the building of areas of influence. So, for instance, you know, the era of the European Union, the era of the growth of the United Nations. I think we can see some glimpses now where the creation of certain, shall we say, super imaginary spaces, such as the notion of Europe, are now being undermined and queried. So the events that have occurred in Greece very recently have certainly made a lot of people nervous in Europe as to what Europe really means. And in fact, whether we're just talking about Germanic hegemony. And certainly, I think it's probably put a stop to the growth of the European ideal. It was only about maybe 5 years ago that everybody was sitting around talking about a European constitution. I think that is no longer on the table. So things are definitely changing with the collapse of those super imaginaries. Then we need to fall back to certain ideas of nation building. And guess what? That's what higher education has been used for in the past, and it's something that could be utilized for again. So we might see there is the potential for repurposing, maybe moving backwards or forwards to different functions for higher education as the nation state takes on new challenges over the next 10 years. And I think that that really is going to occur. And the second area, ironically, when you think about neoliberalism and its connection with libertarianism, is people power. And we have been seeing, which I think is a hopeful sign in the US quite recently, the way in which people have started, ordinary people, parents have started to reject the emphasis on testing regimes and benchmarking for the development of their children, as opposed to what we might consider to be, I don't know, the notion of being educated, whatever that really means. So it was only a few years ago where the Common Core and the type of testing that we see through PARC, for instance, was considered to be the next step, and everybody was going to do it. I think that the people power that we've seen over the, especially over the last year, where parents have turned around and saying, we're not going to allow our kids to be involved in that pilot. We're not going to say, we're not going to allow our kids to test. That the withdrawal from that process could be an interesting way forward, an interesting way of protesting that type of regime and its linkage to education, the indirect state control over education. I think finally, even though I think that the unions have not necessarily been very good at picking up on these issues, particularly the marginalization of academia now within the university sector, I do think at a certain point there may be an interesting backlash. Right now, academia is kind of huddled in a corner. And some people are very seduced with the money through that privatization of public reason. But I do think that there is still an emphasis on academics being partners within the university. And I hope that we will get to a point where institutions find it impossible to function without a good relationship with its academic community. So there may be a kind of a movement backwards, I hope, in the next 5 years. So those are three ways in which we might be able to see a way forward. I'm still waiting for a kind of neo-Marxism, but that's another story.
I think what we're seeing and what we want to see more of is youth-led, state-based organizing. And there are tons of groups out there that are already doing it. Groups like the Dream Defenders, the Ohio Student Association, the Oregon Student Association, the Virginia Student Power Network, the Southern Vision Alliance, the Michigan Student Power Network. And what makes these organizations so exciting is, one, their youth focus. Two, their explicit power-building nature. These are groups of young people coming together to build power to make all of our lives better. And three, the multi-issued nature these organizations develop. You know, these groups are working on things like climate justice, fossil fuel divestment, prison divestment. They're shutting down streets in Black Lives Matter protests. They're working to empower trans folks. They're working on immigration justice and to stop deportations. And they're working to make college free for everyone. And I think that these youth-based organizations have such a critical role to play. I think, one, when you have a group of young people organized at the state-based level, they could do things like team up with labor, team up with different political organizations, so both groups are improving, and they can really turn off people to vote. But what's even better is that although these groups work on building electoral power and exerting that, they're not just relying on turning people out to vote in elections every few years. They're actually trying to change the world. So what I think we need to see is these organizations develop in all 50 states. And what's going to make that so important, and why this is so important, is because right now there's not a lot going on nationally. Because of congressional dysfunction, it makes national organizing on issues that matter pretty much impossible. But hopefully in a few years, that's not going to be the case. And that'll be because these organizations are leading the vanguard and training the next generation of movement leaders. And it's exciting to know that when we look back on this in a few years, when we look back on the development of these state-based organizations, we're going to say, hey, this was so important. And I'm glad that it happened, and I'm glad to be a part of it right now.